All right. Thank you, Donnie. It is a happy day. Beautiful day outside, and we have special speakers, plural. This morning, Carl and Marie Agee. Somehow, years ago, Carl persuaded the talented, the lovely, the saintly, thank you, Donnie, the wily, intelligent Marie Bryant to marry him. She even changed her name to Marie Bryant Agee. They have two lovely children and four grandchildren. Okay. Carl is a civil engineer. Now, some of you don't think Carl even went to college, but he did, and shortly thereafter went to work for IBM. He wore a suit and tie every day. Used to. He started his own business. Maybe something like my business, every few years it's a nonprofit. But I think Carl did much better than that. Marie, for over 20 years, was the stateside director of health talents and has led over 100 medical missions. And she wrote a book. Actually, this is the book. We're giving one of those away. Please help me welcome a couple who have postponed their nationwide book tour to come and teach class today, Carl and Marie Agee.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. We need to get up before he says anything else.
Nathan, are you here? Nathan. He's not here. He's gone. He would appreciate what I'm about to tell you. Okay. We had a visitor earlier today, but when he heard we would be up here, I guess he left. His name is Nathan Heisler. He visited us first about 3-4 weeks ago. I recognized his name in the visitor list and wrote to him. And I shared with him this morning because I was having trouble understanding them. I'm a little bit hard of hearing. So I just now know that I heard Russ say this morning, we have special speakers, bull. Or was it plural?
Plural.
Maybe he said plural. Okay. Enough for the lighthearted stuff. What has guided us for a long, long time are two passages of Scripture, Proverbs 3 and 6. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct the paths. And Romans 8:28. Those that love the Lord and are called according to his purpose, things will work out for them. This class that Russ has put together has served such a great purpose because we've come to know each other a whole lot better than we ever would have had it not been for this class. And I promise you that you're about to know us a whole lot better than you ever have. We come in here on Sunday morning and we put on our best faces. And I hear things like, how are you doing? Well, I'm great. Everything okay at home? Absolutely. Everything is wonderful. Again, someone else, how are you doing? And they'll answer, fine. Well, we're about to describe for you what fine means to us right now.
We have to stay on script. But first, you need to know where we came from.
Yeah. I'm the oldest of three children and the only male child. And, not bragging, but it's a fact, I was the favored child. That's not to be funny. That's the truth. And it plays into what takes place the rest of this morning. I was raised by a stay-at-home mom, and she was assisted by a World War II Marine vet who came home from the war an alcoholic. Not day in, not day out, but occasionally he was. Marie, on the other hand, oh, by the way, being the oldest and the favorite child, I got what I wanted when I wanted it. Marie, on the other hand, was the fifth of seven children. My siblings were girls, both. Learned to share on the day that she was born. She never got a bike until the kid older than her was through with it. And she never, ever even had her picture made until she was two. Your time.
All right.
That's not a stretch. That's the truth.
That's a secret to our being happily married. We do what he wants. What he wants. We have been married forever, it seems like. Sometimes, seriously, it's 53 years now, 53 and a half years now, I think. I was 18. Do we have the picture on the board? We put that on Facebook for our last anniversary. I was 18, but I was almost 19, just a couple of weeks before I was 19, and Carl was 21, almost 22. Do look at that picture. We seemed like we were such babies at the time, and we were. But we loved God, and we loved each other, and we thought we could make it work. But it wasn't all fun and games, all 53 years of it. No, 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 don't let your mind go crazy. It wasn't anything like any affairs or any near divorces or anything like that, nothing like that. Just adjusting to life together, starting a career, raising babies, and sending them out into the world creates drama enough for all of us. From the age we were at the age of accountability, we each knew we wanted to live a Christian life. From the time I was an early teenager, I prayed that God would send me someone who felt as I did. Carl spent all his dating years taking his dates to church, not because he was necessarily devout, but because they were free.
Not the girls. The church services were free.
We met at Tennessee Tech because he was a student at Tennessee Tech, and every other weekend he would preach at the little country church that my great aunt Nora, who was a mentor of mine, lived and worshiped. There weren't any men at that dying little church, so Aunt Nora served as an elderess. She took care of everything that needed to be taken care of, including getting students from Tennessee Tech to come and preach. And after they would preach, she would take them home with them and feed them lunch. So this had been going on a year or so. And he went to her house one day for lunch and happened to spy my picture from my graduation from high school picture on her piano. And the rest is history. We married about a year later, and we were poor as church mice. I worked while Carl finished getting his degree, and we moved to Birmingham in 1966. So 51 of our 53 years have spent right here. In fact, they started at the Homewood Church of Christ for the first several years we were here. That's really where our story begins. When we were talking about what to do, we decided to take several significant things that happened to us through the years and show how it impacted our lives later on. And they weren't all good, they weren't all scary, but from each one, we learned a valuable lesson. So at this point, Carl's going to tell you about the first one.
And you were supposed to tell them that the benefit that they have this morning is that they will know when we're through how all but one of these stories has ended. But at the time, we had no idea. We this morning particularly are believers in angels, one in particular. His name was Arthur Christian.
Appropriate.
Appropriate name. Thanksgiving, 1963. And I'm hanging around the college finishing up some of my schoolwork while Marie finishes up with her job for the State Department of Education. And when she finishes and can lock the office door, we're leaving to go and visit my parents for the Thanksgiving weekend. She has prepared some food, best we could do on our meager budget, and we head on the road and take off toward Adairville, Kentucky, which is just north of Nashville, barely across the line.
On Highway 70, which was not an interstate.
That's right. Two lanes only and no cell phones. As a driver, I decide in error that there's plenty of room and time for me to pass the 18-wheeler in front of me on this two-lane road. I decide too late that there's not enough time to pass the 18-wheeler, and I decided the wrong way to take to the left shoulder of the road. That was my left shoulder, from my passing lane into the left shoulder. Unfortunately, Arthur Christian, coming from the other direction, took the same shoulder. And we met head on the shoulder of the road. Quite a calamity. Nobody was seriously injured. Am I leaving anything out yet?
I want to add something. I was tired because I had been under a lot of stress. So I had laid down in the seat, and I realized he was slowing down dramatically. So I raised up just in time to see these headlights coming at us. So I laid back down and braced, and we hit. And when I raised back up, Carl was gripping the wheel like this. And I said, calm down, no problem, we've got insurance. Because just 2 days before, I had asked him, did you pay that car insurance payment?
That's not the worst part. The worst part is I said yes. We had neither collision nor liability insurance. Arthur was an angel. He was probably at that time about the age we are today. Maybe not quite as old as we are, but close. And he had crash landed at least twice during the Second World War. But he'd never been hurt like he was hurting at that moment in the chest. So Arthur made two demands of us. I want you to pay for my bill at the hospital when I go to have my chest x-rayed. And I want you to get my car fixed. And if you'll do that, we'll do fine. So we signed papers that we would pay Arthur what came to be the total bill, $82, at the rate of $20 per month. And we did that. But in the meantime, Arthur saw us walking about Cookeville because we had no car of our own. He saw us walking about Cookeville carrying groceries. And so we never could prove for sure, but we think we know what happened because after we made the last payment, that very same amount of money came back into our checking account with an anonymous receipt at the bank. Angels were there that day, at least one.
We've remembered Arthur Christian and bless his name ever since then. I'm sure he's dead now, but I'm sure he's one of those angels up there in heaven. The next part of the story is we're going to only deal with briefly, but it was when the deal Carl and I had when we got married was that I would work while he went and got his degree, and then he would work while I went to school and got my degree. Well, by the time he got out of school, I was ready to have a baby. So we moved to Birmingham, and within 6 months, I was pregnant, and we were all ecstatic. But sadly, 5.5 months into the pregnancy, I went into premature labor and delivered our baby girl. I said I wasn't going to cry when I do this, but anyway, it was really hard. Of course it was hard. There's no way it could be not hard. And at the time, the doctor who was our doctor at the time, who happened to be a member of this church at the time, said very flippantly, I thought, you know, don't worry, you're young, you can have other children. And of course we did. Put up the second slide, please. Yeah, we did have two children for whom we were very blessed, but David is the little boy who was screaming, that was his normal tone at that point. And Joanna was a babe in arms. But we almost lost her. The same thing happened to her when I was 6 months along. I went into labor, but this time they were able to stop it. So we decided not to have any more children. We just had those two. And they were just the love of our lives. And because having gone through the trauma of not bringing a baby home from the hospital, these kids were the loves of our lives. And this is when they were in high school. David was a senior and Joanna was a sophomore, I guess, in that picture. And today, David will be 49 this year and Joanna will be 47. The next story, I also have to start. During this time, the next story starts when we'd been married 10 or 15 years, something like that. The children were in elementary school, I remember that. And for years, we had had this little problem in our relationship because Carl could be what I perceived as being very controlling. And, you know, in the beginning, being the fifth child of seven, I'm used to making allowances for people and getting along. But as time went by, I began to get a little more tired of it. And it seemed to be centered in one particular area of our relationship. It seemed to be centered about my being away from home. If he was there, he wanted me there. He didn't want me to go on church retreats. I did anyway, but he didn't like it. And when the kids came along, he didn't like to stay with them and have me go off and do anything by myself. I would say, Carl, could you keep the kids so I can go to the grocery store? Well, which grocery store are you going to? What do you have, a long list or a short list, or how long are you going to be, when do you think you're going to be back? And at first, I really would try to give him honest answers, but then I got, frankly, just got kind of tired of it. I thought, what is this? I'm with these kids all day long. So I finally, towards the end, started saying, when he would say, when are you going to be back, I would give him a definite time, and I would deliberately be 30 minutes late. And I know, I have to answer for that someday. But I thought, you know, come on, this is ridiculous. Well, in this one particular time, we'd gone through that same scenario. He kept the kids. It was summertime. I told him I would be home by 7:30. About 8 o'clock, true to my program, I turned the corner by our house on the street. And he's standing out in the middle of the street. And I'm going, oh, man, here we go again, you know? And so he doesn't realize it's me until I'm almost to the house. And then he runs in, and I come in. And I can tell he's upset. His back is to me. And I run in the house behind him, and I say, Carl, stop it. What is it? Turn around and look at me. And he turned around and looked at me. And he was hysterical. I have never seen that look in his eye before. And I said, what in the world is going on here? It can't have anything to do with me. I've never done anything to cause you this kind of pain. What is this? And he said,
I'm sorry. I can't help it. But when you're not back at the time you said you would be back, I go back to standing on the road or sitting on the porch or looking through the window with my mother, wondering if my alcoholic father would ever be back. And it was my ability to confess that problem and that challenge in my life that made the difference for Marie for the next 40 years. From that time forward, you might ask me some days, where's Marie? And I could barely tell you what country she was in. I didn't worry about that anymore. That's the truth.
That is the absolute truth. Once he said those words, he realized where that anxiety and where that fear was coming from. Then he could put it where it belonged. It didn't belong in the middle of our relationship. And that was nothing but a gift from God to have that come out. Because I had no idea of any of that. But that combined... Okay, that combined with some of the illnesses that we've had, and we've had more than our share in our marriage. I have a genetic hearing loss, and I've had 5 hearing operations, ear operations in my life. I spent 25 years battling colitis. I've had breast cancer, and the day we opened our Health Talent Surgical Clinic in 2002, he was recovering from a AAA aneurysm where he almost died so bad that he had a near-death experience. You ask him about that sometime. We don't have to tell you about that. But Carl's being able to understand where his fear of abandonment came from freed me up to say yes when the Health Talents Board asked me to be the full-time director in 1989. And that was about the time our children were graduating from high school. I had been working for Health Talents 14 years. Part-time, and my office was our kitchen table. And we were probably the only people that anybody ever knew who had a 4-drawer filing cabinet in the kitchen. But we did. We lived like that. My daughter wrote an essay to me one time on my birthday, and she said something like, most kids would come in from school with the smell of cookies. She would come in smelling the smell of ink, where we had a fresh printing delivery. But that was our life. But Health Talents International is a nonprofit. Some of you know some of this, and some of you don't. So I only have a little bit of time to cover it. But Health Talents has a ministry of providing medical care in the name of Jesus. And we do that primarily in Guatemala. Once a year, I go to Nicaragua to do a team. But when they asked me, when the position came open as the director in 1989, the board asked me to do it. And at that time, there were no women running any ministries in the Church of Christ in a public way. And so, naturally, I was very reluctant. I'm going, how can I do this? How can I meet with elderships? And how can I meet with missions committees? Will anybody talk to me? And the board was unwavering. They said, Marie, nobody knows this ministry better than you do. We want you to do it. Do everything you can. And if you need help, let us know and we'll help you. So on that basis, I started doing this. And we started working full-time in the ministry. And it was a family ministry, even though it had been the last 14 years. We started taking medical teams to Guatemala. Show the next picture, please. And we began seeing things like this. And our target population was the Mayan Indians, and on a social scale, the Mayan Indians were lower than anything you can ever imagine because of language, because of money, because of lack of political power. They had no voice in anything. They took the dregs of society, and there was no one ever advocating for them. So we would see things like this. Let's show the next picture, please. Babies who needed cleft palate repair, no way to get them fixed. And some were a lot worse than that precious little girl is. But for a couple of years, we kept going down there and seeing this. And a medical missionary who lived down there, Dr. Mike Kelly, who would host our teams when we would go, had talked to us one day, and he said, what we need desperately is a surgical clinic, a way to help these people have surgery. Because if they go to the national hospital, they will not be treated. They will not be treated. I've heard horror stories. One of a woman who was having trouble delivering a baby, a Mayan Indian woman, and she went to the hospital, and even in the hospital waiting room, they wouldn't do anything, and she ended up having the baby on the floor of the hospital. There's situations where that desperate. So because Carl and I had personally been through so many of these illnesses, the idea of offering medical care in the name of Jesus was so valuable. It made me feel to the marrow of my bones the importance of what we were doing. So we started a clinic. We named it Clinic at Ezel, partly funded by the Ezel family in Nashville. And on the day we were having the dedication, I was only able to go because my two sisters decided or volunteered to come and stay with Carl so I could go to that clinic for the grand opening of the clinic. And through that clinic, we are able to make all sorts, show the next picture, please. We are able to do things. Oh, there's the clinic today. What you saw initially was just the first building. This is what it looks like today. And through that clinic and my experiences there and some of those 100 different trips I've taken, I wish I had time to tell you all the miracles, and I believe they are miracles that I've seen there. I'll tell you two very briefly. One was my job was always to inventory the medical supplies and the surgical supplies that we would bring. Bear in mind, I'm not a surgical person. I had no idea what these things were, but I could match like things together and put them up where somebody who knew what they were doing could find them. And we would, every time we went on one of these early trips, which were well before 9/11, it was in the early 90s, we would all bring duffel bags filled with medical and surgical supplies. And one time I personally checked 13 bags of medical supplies. But when we get to the clinic, and this was not the clinic that we operated then, this is our newer clinic. We were in another clinic for 10 years first. But when we first decided to, I have to tell you this story, this is the first miracle. When the Board of Health Talent sat around the table and voted that we would indeed expand to surgical ministries, they took a vote, it was unanimous, they looked across the table at me and said, okay, Marie, let's do surgery now in Guatemala. And I sat there thinking, how in the world, what do you do? But the first miracle, I'm telling you, within 6 weeks, we were doing eye surgery in Guatemala. And when they said that to me, we had no building, we had no beds, we had no x-rays, we had no operating room tables, we had no operating room lights. In 6 weeks, it's like the floodgates of heaven opened. And our basement was so full, I said it's a family affair, our basement in Homewood was so full, we could barely make it from the back door up the stairs. Because we kept having big 18-wheelers come and put things in my basement until we could get them shipped off to Guatemala. But the one story that I remember that was so vivid, I was sitting, the surgery was started, and I was in the middle of the supply room with all these bags of stuff just piled, and I'm sorting them out, taking them out, and I picked up something I'd never seen before, and this is like our third or fourth surgical trip that we had. It was about this big around, about 6 inches around, about that thick, and it had plastic tubing wrapped all around it, and it was sterile. It was in sterile packaging, and I looked at it. I sat and looked at it for a few seconds and thought, what in the world is that? And I laid it to one side. I swear, not 10 minutes later, the circulator nurse from the operating room came running in and said, Marie, we've got to have a HemoVac right now, with tension in her voice. And I said, I don't even know what a HemoVac is. And she said, it's about this big, about this thick, and got plastic tubing wrapped all around it. And I said, oh, yeah, I just had that in my hand. And I reached and gave it to her. It's the first time we'd ever had one of those, and it's the first time we needed one, and God made sure it was there. So the surgical ministry has just been a blessing, not only to me, but to the hundreds and hundreds of thousands of people literally in Guatemala. That little girl's picture I showed you earlier now has her lip repaired because of this surgical clinic. And the next picture, this is a typical surgical team today. When I was first started doing it, we would have 20 to 25 people on the team. Today, we run three operating rooms full force for 4 days, and it takes about that many people to do it. And we have 10 of those groups throughout the year that go to do surgery. So God has just really blessed that ministry, and I feel really grateful, and I know Carl does, that we've been able to be a small part of that. And one more thing that I want to mention about Health Talents. Just flip to the next picture, please. The girl in the blue is Manuela Tambriz. She's a Quiche Indian girl. Remember what I said about the Mayan women, or the Mayans in general? They have no place in society. She is a Mayan Indian girl, and she is a dentist. She became a dentist because of the blessings of a Health Talent scholarship, and she is a wonderful child. Who is now an adult. I've known her since she was 3 years old, and now she works in our clinic. And the good news is that Homewood Church of Christ now supports her part-time as part of our missions budget, so you'll be seeing and hearing more about her. I hope I can bring her up here one day and let you meet her. Her story is remarkable in and of itself. Carl?
And as she told you earlier, that would never have happened these last 25, 30, 35. We've lost count. Something over 100 trips to Guatemala. They might never have happened.
At least with us.
With us, had she not asked me, why are you crying? Why are you hysterical? And until she asked me that, I wasn't conscious of why I was crying. But I was able to tell her, and so now, to this day, if she tells me I need to make a quick trip to wherever, I'm okay with that. I've adopted her theory. It's no more dangerous than North Birmingham. It's just not.